and welcome to Beyond Focus TV. I am so happy, like, and excited because I have a great announcement for you. We are here with District Leader, Ms. Rodney Schott. She is the 42nd Assembly Representative. We're going to take a short break and we're coming back. I'll introduce her to you. And then with my big special announcement, we'll be right back. Welcome back. Before we took a break, I did tell you that we're going to have an extreme announcement in Brooklyn. But you're just going to have to hold on for like 2 minutes after I introduce my district leader, Ms. Rodney Schott.
Hello, how are you?
I am great, thank you. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Oh, thank you.
First, okay, let me go back because I think I would love for the community to understand who you are. How did you get here? What made you run for a district leader and all that great stuff?
Okay, well, my name is Rodney Schott. I am the district leader of the 42nd Assembly, which covers the Flatbush, East Flatbush, Midwood part of Brooklyn.
Okay,
that area is highly populated with Caribbean Americans, and we have a good portion of Orthodox Jews in the district. Okay. I ran in 2010, and I felt there was a need for leadership in the community after the earthquake that happened in 2010, January 12. I went to Haiti, came back, and realized that the people on the ground, you know, our Haitian brothers and sisters, they didn't have any advocacy, didn't have anyone to advocate for them, didn't have any resources in terms of where to go for help, and they pretty much had their hands sticking out, you know, not knowing where to go for help. So I felt at that point there was a need for someone to be on the ground to kind of work with the elected officials and be a leader and a voice for not only the Haitian people, but for all, you know, for all the people.
It's interesting that you said that because I think one of my questions to everyone is usually like anyone that's running, that, that ran for a politic position or that are in a position within a political party is the aspect of why you ran. And then you're saying like understanding like, although we have a large Haitian community, we don't have a person, like a ground person who says, okay, you know what, let's go to this person and they'll take over whatever it is next for us. And reading your blog, I understand that you're the first Haitian woman to hold a position.
Yes, I'm the first Haitian woman to ever get elected in any office in the city of New York.
Yes.
And of course, district leader. I'm the first Haitian.
So, quick question though, because I know, and I hate to ask that, but I have to.
Sure, no problem.
How does that make you feel though?
That makes me feel great, but it motivates me to encourage others to run, because obviously having one or two elected in the community is not enough.
Okay.
So that just put me in a position to show other people that it's possible and there's a way to do it. You know, pretty much getting in the system will afford a person to help the broader community by guiding them to the right people.
Guiding them to the right people.
Exactly.
I met with a young man the other day and we were talking, having this whole great conversation about position, political position, and how they feel like, I mean, I personally think each of us, we have our own personal position as to what we think needs to be done within a community.
Correct.
What is your most goal, like the one thing that you think Brooklynites would benefit from?
From the district leader position?
Yes.
Well, I think information sharing is critical. Oftentimes, our constituents, so the people, they have issues, but they don't know what type of elected officials can help them.
Yes.
So because our community is heavily populated with immigrants, I guess they think a council person or assembly person or state senate can help them with immigration issues. But really, because it's a federal matter, it's our congresspeople who can help. So with issues like that, I take these calls and I first educate them.
Exactly.
And then I tell them, okay, I'm going to put you in touch with someone who's in that federal office who may be able to help you. And before I do that, I typically call the person from the office and say, hey, this is the issue. This person's going to reach out to you. Can you please help?
Okay.
And that's what I do. So taking the time to educate our constituents and, you know, pretty much responding to them is a big step forward.
Okay. Which is, mm-hmm. you know, I don't know. Like, I'm from Haiti. Like, I was mm-hmm. born in Haiti. So I understand the whole concept of, you know, you have that just one person mm-hmm. who oversees everything else. Doesn't right. matter what the, you know, you have the power. You can mm-hmm. oversee everything.
Exactly.
You know, so right. we're used to that. We're used right. to, like, right. oh, you know, like, she's a district leader. She's going right. to get me a visa.
Right, exactly.
You know, don't have that role. So
I wish I did.
you know, for us, mm-hmm. it works totally differently. You know, it's being in a position, mm-hmm. being able to help a community wide, mm-hmm. and it's not just, you know, for us, for mm-hmm. the Haitian community, it's for like the community in itself, the right. whole Brooklynite, you know, you're there for them.
Right, and you know, I've penetrated my community pretty well, mm-hmm. And so it's not only Haitians, nor Caribbeans, mm-hmm. or Blacks, but I do penetrate the Jewish area as well, mm-hmm. you know, other nationalities, and I've actually, you know, set up meetings to work on their issues, which is, you know, education.
Exactly.
So I take the time to kind of pull the different parts of the district and see what, you know, what are the issues that the people are facing.
Okay.
And one thing that you should know, that the district leader position is not a paid job.
I know.
So, yeah.
I know. I listened to it.
Yes. You thought it was paid?
No. I was just reading. I'm like, ah.
It's not a paid job, but it does give itself an opportunity to be exposed
yeah.
to other opportunities, and it's kind of a stepping stone to others, to other positions. So,
but you, would mm-hmm. you say that this is really, you would have to really want to do this?
Yeah.
Because it's mm-hmm. like, everywhere I turn, mm-hmm. there you are.
Right.
You know, attending events, mm-hmm. you know, having different discussions, mm-hmm. meetings with different people.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to really want to do this.
Right. Because I just felt there was a need. Community service and servicing mm-hmm. people is pretty much second nature for me. I've been doing it for a very long time. And when I was introduced to this particular position, I mm-hmm. figured that, wow, this is great because I can work my regular job mm-hmm. and get paid there and still do the services I can for the people. In addition to that, this position also appoint the Supreme Court Justice.
Okay.
So that's also another opportunity to get exposed to the judges
yeah.
in Kings County. And we also control and give jobs to people on Election Day. So all the people that you see working behind the polls, mm-hmm. I hire them.
Okay, mm-hmm. that's good.
Yeah.
So I'm so glad that, you know, even I am being educated about it. I mean, I knew mm-hmm. about the part that you were not getting paid, mm-hmm. but I didn't know.
the
aspect that it comes with it, mm-hmm. You know, understanding like how it works in itself, mm-hmm. and education,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is what I think the community needs all around 24/7.
Right.
And
mm-hmm.
one of the things that my producer talks about mm-hmm. is what he would want to do for the community is to mm-hmm. educate the community. We do the show,
mm-hmm.
of course, you know, we're not getting
right.
paid either.
We do.
Well, that's good.
You know, like, yeah.
Kindness of your heart,
you know,
right. I mean, to support his idea mm-hmm. of how he would love for the community to get to know certain things, understanding mm-hmm. how we work within mm-hmm. the community.
One thing, if you don't mind,
no, go ahead.
Is part of this district leader also is to get people civically engaged.
Mm-hmm.
So very often our people have a lot of needs, but they don't know how to get their issues addressed.
Yeah.
And one of the ways is you know, being a voter registrant,
mm-hmm.
Voting,
mm-hmm.
and participating in the civic engaged activities in the community.
Okay.
And people just don't know. And you know, the people who are part of community boards or, you know, what
yes.
used to be school boards
mm-hmm.
or community council precincts, these are the people who know how to reach
to
the people.
You know what, I have a quick question.
Sure.
I have a really great question
okay, sure.
About this.
Mm-hmm.
But, we're going to take a break because I think
okay.
I need, this. I need
okay,
some
great.
Water before we do this. We're
going to
take a short break. We'll come right back with Ms. Rodney's Bichotte. Welcome back to Beyond Focus TV. My name is Angie, of course, you know that. And we are here with Ms. Rodney's Bichotte. Before we took a break,
mm-hmm.
We were talking about like how we would do the drive
mm-hmm.
for voters.
Mm-hmm.
I remember, you know, probably in the late 90s or 2000s, I don't want to say about
so
there was always this drive like before like a year, probably a couple of months before voting season, that there would be a drive like to get people to become citizens. And then they would look for volunteers. Because I think a lot of the time is that we have people who would be able to vote, but they don't know, you know, the benefit of voting, and then they don't understand, like, you have to become a citizen for you to be able to do certain things. Right. So do we still have that going?
Yeah, in fact, I know Senator Parker and Senator Eric Adams, they do a really good New America citizen drives.
Okay.
So it's helping them fill out the form to become citizen, but coupled with that, they fill out the voter's registration. So you're right, there's a lot of new Americans who are not registered to vote because they don't know.
Yeah.
So currently there's a big push for voter's registration. NAACP is in the front lines and pushing that initiative because there's been suppression on voter registration.
And people don't know, really, this is what information is all about.
Exactly. I mean, right now they're making it harder for minorities and seniors to vote because they're requiring IDs, you know, IDs that are very, like, you know, far-fetched, getting a birth certificate, things like that. Some people don't even know what a birth certificate is, right? Yeah. So, or if their IDs are expired, it takes a while to get their IDs, you know,
crazy
renewed.
Stuff, yeah.
Right, so, and it's impacting the minority community and seniors because, again, having access or having time to get that renewed.
So just trying to let people understand that, you know, you need to be able to keep up to date version of everything that you have, because within the community in itself, there are certain things that are being done to keep you at a distance from making choices for yourself.
Exactly.
Like, politically correct.
Another thing we're trying to do, we're trying to talk to youth.
Yes.
So we're looking to go into the high schools to grab the 17, 18 years old and see if we could do a voter's registration. I mean, you have to be 18 to be eligible to vote.
But just understanding it, like, will probably give you a better idea of what it is to be a voter and what you would benefit from it.
Exactly.
Like, you get to make your own choices. I think the idea at the end part of it is that you get to make your own choices.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
So,
and everybody should exercise that right to vote.
Yeah, but not a lot of us do.
They don't.
I think information, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Again, you need to let people know, you know, the district leader or the senator or anybody else get to make decisions for you. But if you are involved within the community that where you live at, you get to make choices, because that's how you become a district leader.
Exactly.
And just making the choices, like, you know what, this is not there. Let me make a choice and make that happen.
Exactly.
So, remember my big announcement. Should we do it now?
Sure.
All right. So, Ms. Bichette have a great announcement to make. So, take it away.
Well, after consulting with friends, family, electeds, and community leaders and constituents in the community, I have taken the step forward to run for higher office.
Yay.
And I'm running for New York State Assembly in my district in the 42nd Assembly.
Oh, my God. When I heard that, I'm like, are you really seriously?
Yes.
Because this is a lot.
It's a lot of work.
Yes.
But, you know, the community is in need. So this is a decision that was not only made by me, but made by the community. I mean, we need new leadership. We need progressive movement. And we need people who's going to really advocate for us in Albany.
Exactly.
There's a lot of stuff that's going on in our community that's really imminent that we need to address, like unemployment.
Yes.
Unemployment is pretty high. It's about
healthcare.
Healthcare. As you know, all the hospitals are closing or consolidating.
Yes.
10 out of 15 hospitals in Brooklyn are impacted. And that's interesting for us because the majority of the people in our district are healthcare workers.
Yes. Not only that, they're healthcare workers, a lot of the patients live right here.
Exactly.
And we have people who are, you know, one of the things I always have in conversation with one of my friends, and I explained to her, is that people are being stressed out from not getting a job. So now you have a stressed out person who's in the street. Who, God knows what's going on in their mindset.
Exactly.
So you have Brooklyn, you know, being invaded in both parts.
Exactly.
Jobs are closing. There's no healthcare system for them. There's nothing for them to benefit from.
Exactly.
So having a person like yourself as a representative.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's a lot that can be done, but definitely I'll be on the forefront of, you know, voicing the people's concern and making sure that legislation is put in place so that these hospitals are not closed.
Okay.
You know, and there's a better plan than going to, especially the predominantly minority areas, that's going to impact them. So there should be a better plan than to consolidate all these hospitals.
I don't understand how can you do that, possibly, with Kingsborough itself.
Right.
Like, you know, you have a psych unit, and then you determining, like, should I do mini, mani, mo with a patient today?
Exactly.
And just send you outside with, you know, medication. I mean, I think we are not, I don't think people are aware of how bad the situation is,
within
the community.
It's huge, because those are 2,000 patients.
Yes.
Yeah. Those are 2,000 patients going to be, has to go to Staten Island.
Yes.
So that's critical.
And some of them have the choice of not going. They
right.
do.
Right.
They still need the medication.
Mm-hmm.
They still need to be in a facility.
Exactly.
However, they're giving them the right to. I don't understand how that works. And it's a little bit, you know, eerie to even think about or to talk about in public, because I think the community need to understand how that works, how closing, you know, a psych unit and having these patients closing a hospital. Like, if there's something happened in your house and you live in this area and you have to travel,
travel to Staten Island, pay these high fares to go over there. And then, not only that, but a lot of the jobs are being taken away.
Yeah.
You know, it's a couple of thousand jobs that are impacted.
I know.
So, it's crazy.
It's crazy. So, you know.
And that's a state issue. So, that will be addressed.
I was really excited, so I wanted to talk about that. But you know, I understand you're going to the Black Caucus.
Yes, I am going to the Black Caucus. Yes.
How does that make you feel, too?
It makes me feel great because I'm going to be among colleagues.
Exactly.
And you know, I think this year is an Obama year, and we're just getting excited for his reelection, as well as a lot of the activities that's going on on the local level. So there's a couple of things. First, I would like to address that I was nominated and selected as Obama delegate.
Yes.
So I will be going to North Carolina representing Brooklyn, and I'll be close to my dear friend, President Barack Obama, who I worked with before. Right now, there's a number of people who's going to be running, okay, because there are some seats that will be open. There are new lines that are being drawn, and that's continuously being fought, you know, at the court levels. And also the primary day for voting is being pushed up to June 26th.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit chaotic, but exciting. And so I think there's going to be a lot of excitement in Albany.
Okay, but would people get to know and understand that the difference of the date, what it means? Because I think, like, you know, community-wise, people don't really understand the differences. Can you just give me a little bit of an idea of what that is?
So, June 26th primary, that was a law that was instituted for the military folks, because the military folks then have an opportunity to vote, to get their votes in. They would do the absentee vote. So they had to push it by law for any type of federal voting. So the congressional race, so our Yvette Clarks, our Ed Towns, our Anelia Velasquez, all those people, they are going to run in the June 26th primary.
Okay.
Now, the state legislation election, like the state Senate, the state assembly, that's still being decided on.
Okay.
They don't know if they're going to lump it with the June 26th or whether it's going to be in August or whether it's going to be in September.
Okay.
So typically, we vote primary in September, and then we have a general election in November. We're also going to have another election in April, and that's the primary, the presidential primary.
I know.
So there's a lot going on this year, and it's going to confuse people, which may cause a low turnout, unfortunately.
Okay. Well, you know, that's the reason why we have Beyond Focus TV. We have people like yourself. You know, you can come in and explain to people this is what you need to do, and have community-based services where we're making these announcements. Because I think a lot of times people are confused when they don't know, when they don't hear about it. You know, it's not like 2000, like the earth is going to crumble.
Right, exactly.
You know, but if people understand the concept of it, because I think what we're doing right now is having a conversation about it, because there are some things that are still in the air.
Right.
So it's not like have decided yet.
Right,
they haven't made that final decision.
Right.
So if you can come back and explain to people, we could even do a chart.
Okay, yeah.
You know,
definitely.
And so people will know, because I think, you know what it is a lot of time people don't know certain things. That they don't know what's available to them. And being able to make that difference, because a lot, you know, most you ask anybody else, they don't vote for the locals.
Right, they don't. It's like they don't know. So exactly. Typically, like in my district, we have about 120,000 members living mm-hmm. in the district. Of that, about 60,000 are Democrat voters. Mm-hmm. Of that, 44,000 are active, so people who voted in the last 5-10 years. And then of that, the people who vote in the primary day on a regular basis, about 5,000.
See, very low. Very low, yeah. Because you know they don't mm-hmm. they don't see the importance of it. They exactly. don't understand it.
Exactly.
But having a person like yourself who's going to come on a TV
right,
show
right,
and
right.
talk about it, and we get to make mm-hmm. that difference. I mean, right. I think it's important. I think people need to take their own lives into their hands mm-hmm. and make decisions because mm-hmm. 2 years, you've mm-hmm. only been in mm-hmm. this position for 2 years, mm-hmm. and I can tell you, mm-hmm. like, you know, I don't want
to
say
less than 2 years.
Yeah, like the type of differences mm-hmm. that you've made. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. You know, thank you.
I mean, mm-hmm. to me, you're very active. Mm-hmm. I see you. You mm-hmm. know, it, like you said, mm-hmm. it's not just mm-hmm. you know the Black community. You mm-hmm. are very active within mm-hmm. Brooklyn Heights itself. Mm-hmm. So you can't imagine mm-hmm. as an assemblywoman mm-hmm. the differences you get to make.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to that.
I look forward to it. I mean, yeah. as an assembly person, I'll be in Albany a lot. We'll be, you know, writing policies and legislations, passing legislation, but. Because it's a paid position, I will have a staff
yeah.
to actually work on my behalf and service the constituents.
Okay.
You know, whatever forums, programs that we have, resources, so.
Okay. Well, you know, like we're talking about like making policies. I'm mm-hmm. going to talk to you about the Shirley Chisholm.
Oh, okay.
Which is
okay.
one of the things that you believe in. But before we do that, mm-hmm. we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. Beyond Focus TV. I am here having a great conversation with Rodney Bichard. And before mm-hmm. we took a break, we were mm-hmm. talking about, you know, you just had the Shirley Chisholm mm-hmm. Tribute.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
My biggest question to her, because mm-hmm. when I'm reading her mm-hmm. life, and do you see a similarities between the two?
Well, that's some definitely big shoes to fill yes. in, but you know, one of the things I said when I first learned about Shirley Chisholm, mm-hmm. I'm like, wow, you know, she's done a lot in the community, and I would definitely want to walk in her trail.
Yes.
And so the Shirley Chisholm tribute mm-hmm. we had a few days ago
yeah.
was to celebrate and commemorate her 40th year of running for president.
Okay.
She's the first Black to ever be in a party line, the Democratic line, to run for president, making an opportunity for people like Jesse Jackson Jr.
Exactly.
Jesse Jackson, sorry, Sr., Al Sharpton, mm-hmm. and our President Obama. So, It's just fascinating to be in a room of people who are commemorating.
Mm-hmm.
And one of her big push was education.
Education.
Exactly.
And, you know, we've talked about this before.
Right.
Like you, so that's
right.
why I'm like, okay. I could see it. I could see it.
So one of the things that I did commit to is to raise $10,000 mm-hmm. and distribute that $10,000 as scholarships to the schools in my district.
Exactly.
And so they, you know, Shirley Chisholm was a person of accountability,
mm-hmm.
Of conviction,
devotion
yeah. and very audacious,
yes.
especially back then.
And you don't see the similarities.
I don't know.
I think it's right there. So I'm like, oh, you know what? This is really good. You know, like our show mm-hmm. is really just 30 minutes long. You and I,
okay.
we could have this conversation forever.
Okay, right.
However, we only have 30 minutes.
Okay.
Is there anything you would love for the community to know, mm-hmm. understand, or mm-hmm. be aware of before we close out?
Again, just, you know, this year is our year,
yes.
and I think that it is important that our people understand the meaning of voting mm-hmm. and really getting involved. We need to get our president back, because if we don't get him back,
we're doomed.
We're doomed.
I'm serious. We are doomed.
We're doomed. And even lower than that, they need to get out and vote for our local officials, because
yes.
these are the people who's going to make direct impact, whether it's the street roads, the mm-hmm. you know, the traffic lights, whether it's the schools closing,
and we
these
have
are
a whole
issues
lot of
exactly
education teachers,
small
hospitals,
businesses,
healthcare, yeah,
exactly. So I would encourage everyone to please go out and vote June 26th and November. I don't know the date of November.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
but if anybody would love to get in touch with you, is there a number, a volunteer, you know, if you need people to just like stuff papers? It doesn't have to be like, oh, you know, you have to write letters. You could stuff envelopes, and that's good
enough. They can actually email me at votebeshort@gmail.com. That's V-O-T-E, B as in boy, I-C-H-O-T-T-E @gmail.com.
Okay. Is there a number to your office?
There is, and I'm trying to remember. I think it's 1-888-410-2340.
Cool. You know, I don't know what else to say. I don't like to sound like I'm boasting anybody. But I think, as a person, we've had multiple conversations before. I think you are doing the right thing. You are in the right path. You're leading a lot of young people after you, and it's incredible to see that. That not only that they think so highly of you and they follow in your footstep, but you're making a difference in so many different ways. I wish you luck.
Thank you so much. And and you know, I will win.
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
Right. I will win.
I love that.
And there's a movement, and I'm going to take everybody with me.
Good. Yes. You know, and I love that. Positive thinking.
Thank you for having me.
No, thank you for being here. Thank you so much.
It's always a pleasure.
No, it's mine. This is the end of our show. I hope that you've learned a lot from this. And look out, we have a lot to tell you. Don't forget June 26th. And she's going to come back to have the chart and talk about like what we need to do as a community to upgrade us, uplift ourselves. If we know better, we'll do better. Yeah. I'm just adapting this whole situation. This is the end of our show. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next Tuesday. Same place, same time. Bye.
Thank you.